Hello, welcome to my channel, or welcome back if you've been here before. My name is Bethanne, and today I'm doing a brief mid-month wrap-up, which is a type of video I haven't done before, so we'll see how this goes for the month of March and if it's something I want to keep doing or not. So I have several books to talk about that I read on my Kindle, but then I also have some hard copy books to talk about in the categories of things that I've read and finished, and also some things that I'm still working on. So the first books that I finished this month was a trilogy of three romance novellas, the Sugar Baby series by Rebecca Weatherspoon, and those are So Sweet, So Real, and So, no, So For Real, So Sweet, So For Real, So Right, something like that. I'll put the correct titles down below. And I did review that series in an earlier video, so I will link that here in the cards. And those were just exactly what I wanted. They were just a quick, fluffy, super happy, feel-good little romance story. About our main character, who's a plus-size Black woman who finds herself out of a job, is starting to need money. Her roommate, who's maybe not so nice a person, convinces her to try a sugar baby website, Sugar Baby Sugar Daddy, where you get hooked up with someone to go for dates on, and ideally, if it works out, he'll pay your rent and stuff. She agrees to go under much duress and pushing and peer pressure from her roommate, but then it's a romance. Obviously, you know where this is going, so I don't think it's a spoiler to say that she finds the love of her life there in a somewhat unexpected way. And then the series unfolds from there. It's a mixed race couple. The man that our main character starts dating is an older white guy, but they have an absolutely lovely relationship. So if you want something that just feels lovely, those were really fun to read. I think I gave them all solid 4 stars. Then the next book I finished this month was also a Kindle read, and it was the poetry collection Transfer by Naomi Shihab Nye. And I read that as a buddy read with Courtney Farriter, and she selected it as part of her Arab American challenge for this year, where she's reading one Arab American author per month. And so she had chosen that one for March, and I was like, oh, I want to read that one too, because I hadn't read any Naomi Shihab Nye prior to that. And of course, she's a very famous poet. So I really wanted to jump in on that. So this collection was quite good. It's almost entirely focused on her father. It's kind of a in memoria of him almost. So he had passed away sometime before the poetry collection was written, and her father is Palestinian, and Shihab Nye herself, I believe, is Palestinian American. And so just so much of the poetry, because she was trying to capture kind of her memories and her sense of her father. So much of it is about kind of his sense of place, his ties to Palestine, and his really kind of overwhelming grief and frustration with the armed conflict in Palestine, the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. And so I found poems that were related specifically to that and his opinions about that conflict to be extremely powerful and moving. You know, a lot of poems that are just kind of about the futility of violence in solving things, which as a Quaker I really appreciated. But so there was definitely that kind of sense of place and that tragedy and some of that experience of him as an immigrant escaping an armed conflict. Were definitely part of a lot of the poetry. There were also quite a few pieces about her memories of him and different aspects of her relationship with him as well, that I found to be really poignant. But then there were also quite a few random poems thrown in. I think Courtney talked about this too. So, you know, sometimes we'd be reading a section and be like, oh, this section appears to be about X, except for these three poems that are totally about something completely different. Unless I was missing something. So that did bump it down for me to more like a 4-star. And I don't need poetry collections to be cohesive and thematic. It's totally fine. Like, I've read poetry collections where the poems are just all over the place because that's what the poet felt like writing. And that's great. But she did in the intro and some of the earlier sections in the book, she did really set it up to be this cohesive thematic piece about her father. And so, especially in some of the later sections, to get these random poems thrown in was a little bit weird. There were even, like, in a collection that's all about your dead father, there were even a couple poems that were dedicated to other people, like a famous poet, I believe Palestinian poet, who had died. And so, like, there is a connection, but it definitely, like, I would then read that poem and then be a little bit jarred. So just to throw that out there, but it was really a beautiful collection, and definitely one that I think I'm going to, reread. So I will link to Courtney's review below. She reviewed it in, or described it in, I think one of her Friday Reads videos recently. So I'll look up the exact video and post it below. I'm sure I know, I've seen her video, so she's much more eloquent about it, I think, than I am. So you should definitely go check that out. So those are my Kindle reads. Those are all my Kindle reads for the month so far. Then another book that I finished, the next book that I finished that I've already talked about, is The Home Place by J. Drew Lanham, Memoirs of a Colored Man's Love Affair with Nature. I read this for the Book Naturalists Book Club, hosted by Heidi over at My Reading Life and Doris at Aldi Books. So I did do a standalone review for this, which I will link below. But you should go check out their channels if you want to see what else we're reading in the Book Naturalists Book Club. This was our February pick, so I haven't started the March pick yet, which is Ecology of a Cracker Childhood by Janice Ray. So far, lots of kind of memoir about people's experiences growing up in nature. And J. Drew Lanham is a very well-renowned Black ornithologist. He's a professor at Clemson University in South Carolina. And this is mostly his story of growing up. That's mostly what this focuses on, I would say. Okay, then the next book I just finished was An Accidental Mammoth. I am doing March of the Mammoths, so actually we can skip ahead just for a second. So my official March of the Mammoth pick is this behemoth, The Count of Monte Cristo, which I'm still in the middle of reading it, with Summer over at Cozy Reading with Quaker Cats and a bunch of people, through her channel. And then I'm also reading it, as a buddy read with Megan's Reading Revelations and a bunch of people in her Discord. So I will post all the appropriate links below if you want to jump in on this with some people to talk about it with. But then I mentioned I read An Accidental Mammoth. So I read this book, epic fantasy book, Ship of Magic by Robin Hobb. This is the first book in her Live Ship Traders series. This is a series, that was published around the turn of the century. This one came out in 1998. And I'm also reading this with Megan's Reading Revelations and folks in her Discord as well. And I say Accidental Mammoth because it turns out that it's 809 pages, which I did not expect it to be. When I picked it up, I was like, oh, it'll be like a 500 page book. I mean, like, look, it's way thinner than The Count of Monte Cristo. This is 1400 pages. This is 800 pages. But yeah, I thought it would be like 500 or 600. So not a mammoth. But it's a mammoth, so I am going to tick that box. Anyway, so this was fantastic. It's about, a magical ship, and there are pirates, and there's family drama, lots of family drama. There is a rogue pirate accidentally doing good deeds. He's a very selfish, awful person, but he kind of ends up He ends up freeing a bunch of slaves, like, over and over and over again as a way to gain power. But it's also just like, oh my gosh, this is so complicated. there's magic, but it's in kind of the background of the story. There are some magical serpents floating around, sea serpents, that are kind of so far playing a role almost like the White Walkers in Game of Thrones. Like, there's this huge threat that kind of occasionally we get glimpses of. That is really, really ancient, and there's a lot going on there that we don't know about yet. It's just been hinted at, so I think they're going to play a much bigger role in later books. So just all kinds of stuff going on. She's such a good writer. Oh my gosh, she's an amazing fantasy writer. She has beautiful prose. It just totally drew me in. Her characters are all incredibly complex and well-fleshed. One mark for me of a good writer is, like, even if I don't like the characters very much, if I still am fascinated by them and want to keep reading. And so with all of her main characters, it's like I don't feel that much connection to them. Like, they don't remind me of me in any ways. You know, they're not, most of them aren't very nice people. Like, even the kind of hero figures are extremely selfish and kind of idiotic sometimes in very human ways, like in ways that make sense. But they're written so compellingly that it's like, even if I think you're being an idiot again, you're being an idiot in the ways that make sense for your character. And so I want to find out what happens. Anyway, now I'm blabbing about this. I think I'm going to do a standalone for that book, standalone review, because I think it is an example of really good fantasy for me. So I'll stop talking about it. Okay, so just to wrap up this video, so I do have two books that I'm currently reading right now. So I already mentioned The Count of Monte Cristo. I will not finish this in March. I never planned to. I planned to space it out over 2 months. So I'll finish this in April, but I'm excited to get farther in it, and I will maybe share some thoughts about what I'm thinking so far in my March wrap-up video. And then I am still doing March of the Moderns. I just haven't made a ton of progress yet because I got distracted by these other things. But I am almost halfway through Jane Addams' 20 Years at Hull House, which I'm really enjoying. It also makes me sad a lot. But really enjoying this look at turn of the 19th century Chicago, the truly horrible conditions in the industrial areas, and then the project of Jane Addams's settlement house and the programs that they were able to do to really alleviate some people living in those poverty-stricken areas. So definitely really enjoying this, and I will talk about it a bit more later in the month, because I'll finish it soon now that I'm done with that fantasy giant. And then I am planning to proceed with my other March of the Moderns picks, which I talked about in my March TBR video, so I'm not going to mention right now since I haven't started them. But if you're also doing March of the Moderns, please let me know, because I am going to try to be more excited about it and check in a lot more about that specifically, like starting next week as I start to finish some of my March of the Moderns picks. So I think, yeah, that's my mid-month wrap-up. So how many books was that? It was the three romances, the poetry collection, Lanham's memoir, and the epic fantasy. So I finished six books so far, which is great, even though some of them were short in various ways. But I'm really happy with that progress. And yeah, we'll see how the rest of the month goes. All right. I hope you're all having a good week. Thanks for tuning in. If you're not subscribed to me already, please go ahead and hit that subscribe button. And I will see you in the next video. Thanks. Bye.